Buster's Farm, Series 2. Who is your neighbor?
Well, it's that time of the year again. We'll have to make that trip to town and get some supplies for the winter. Let's see, we'll need some grain and wheat and some new blankets as well.
I think we'll need some hay as well, Buster, reminded Cruz. Hey, Buster, can I come with you and Mr. P? Can I?
I think you're still a little bit young, little fella. It's a few days' hard journey, and those roads are rough.
Dangerous as well, I might add. Rumors of robbers, bandits, and thieves. As though we need any extra worries to worry about, bristled P.
But I'm no trouble. I can take care of myself, Cruz pleaded.
My boy, if you were half as able as you are willing, I would gladly trade places with you. I'd soon not go out into the world and its dangers.
You'd just soon not go out of your house, mumbled Buster.
Say that what, old man? I said you got the courage of a lion, not a mouse. Not quite what I heard, Peabody poutingly protested.
I'm going to go hitch up the wagon. Y'all make a list of all the things you need, and I'll be ready to go soon.
As Buster made sure the wagon was road ready, the ducks and chickens loaded up the supplies and water Buster and Pea would need for their journey.
Please, don't forget the catnip, purred Captain Hooney.
Here's the money you'll need for our supplies and some for your overnight stays. Spend wisely. We're on a tight budget this year. Be careful for trouble and tricksters, Hootie advised. As they left, young Cruz ran circles around Buster and Mr. P all the way to the road, pleading his case along the way.
Come on, Buster, let me go with you. I'm old enough, I'm big enough, I can help pull the wagon. Come on, Buster.
Maybe next year, little Cruzy. Maybe next year.
Goodbye. Be careful.
Have a good trip, all of the animals said as they waved until Buster and P were out of sight. As they traveled along the road, they would occasionally pass other travelers traveling the opposite way. Buster would cheerfully ask them,
Hey, how y'all doing?
Fine,
how's the road
fine.
Ahead?
Good.
In passing conversation, they would exchange news and tell each other of what was ahead and where they were from.
I say, old man, must you be so friendly to every stranger that we pass? It's just not necessary that we chit-chat with the bric-a-brac we pass along the path. It could be dangerous, I say.
They won't be strangers if you'll say hello and introduce yourself. If we pass them again, they won't be strangers at all, because now I know the names and where they're from. Heck, they're just like neighbors now.
Neighbors? More like strangers who now know all of our business as well. You're quite the social butterfly, oh boy.
As it got later and later in the day, the sun got lower and lower in the sky, and they saw fewer and fewer fellow travelers. Peabody, long since having retired to riding in the wagon, remarked to Buster,
I say, it's getting a bit late to be out here. How about you pick up the pace a bit, eh?
Yeah, that's easy for you to say, Buster reminded.
Just then they heard a whimpering noise, a low moaning for help coming from just ahead.
Look up ahead there, on the side of the road. It looks like that little doggy's hurt, Buster told Pete.
I don't know. It could be a trap, acting like he's hurt, pretending, and when we stop to help him, zoom! His comrades in crime jump out of the woods to rob us. This road is known for such treacheries, packs of wild dogs that rob and hurt travelers traveling through these parts. I say we move to the other side of the road and avoid possible trouble.
But it could be hurt, Buster reminded.
But it could be a trap, my boy. I've seen many of these things in my travels. We don't know who he is. He looks like some mutt left in these parts. A plague among us, if you will, these strays.
Well, if he lives in these parts, that would make him our neighbor, and we should help him.
You don't know who he is.
He's our neighbor.
I think not.
Yeah, that's right, a neighbor. And we should treat our neighbors as we would ourselves, or as a family member.
Good grief, Buster. He's hardly a neighbor. We're a day's journey from home. He's a stranger, a mutt, possibly a nut. I appeal to your senses, old boy. Don't stop and get involved. I smell trouble.
You don't get close enough to smell a rose, because all you see is thorns, Buster chided.
As they approached, it was obvious the little doggie was hurt. He was weak and bleeding, hardly able to speak. He had been robbed of his collar and food.
Goodness, little doggie, what happened? You look terrible. Let me help you. Help me get him up, Mr. P.
Touch him? I think not. There's no telling what I'll catch. Let's go on and send help back.
Well, if that's what you want to do, you go on alone. I'm going to stay here and help him.
Go on alone? On this road? With bandits on the loose? Somewhat like bending me over the barrel here, don't you think? You leave me no choice.
You've always got a choice, Mr. P. Life is full of choices. You decide.
If this is something you think we must do, we're already running late, low on water,
bemoaned P as they helped the little injured dog into the wagon. They gave him some food and water and cleaned and bandaged his wounds. As they continued on, the little dog told them of how he was going up the road. A pack of wild dogs surrounded him, beat him up, and stole his money, food, and water. They had left him there in the ditch.
The absolute lack of humanity these days, it's appalling.
You're wanting to talk, you posh peacock, mumbled Buster.
Yes, but I did stop and help, perked P,
as though trying to petition a pardon for himself. As the sun was setting, they arrived at the next town. Buster got rooms for them, as well as some food and water. He had also called a doctor, a veterinarian, to come out and check the little doggie's wounds. Nothing serious was wrong with the little doggie. He just needed to rest a day or so before traveling again. The next morning, while checking out, Buster told the innkeeper,
"Here's enough money for last night, and here's some more money for the little doggy to stay another day or so, and some money for his food as well. If you could see that he's okay until he can travel again, I'd be much obliged. And if you need more, I'll pay you when we pass back this way on our way home."
As they traveled on, hours had passed, and Peabody had not said a word. He just kept huffing his tail and saying,
"If you got something to say, say it. If you got something on your mind, say it. You might as well get it off your chest."
"Then I will say a word or two about your behavior."
"I knew you would.
Here we are, going to town to get our supplies for the winter, running late on a financial budget, and you take the chance of being robbed, or worse, to help a stranger."
"A neighbor. Fine, a neighbor. You feed him, you give him my water, you care for him, you pay for his room, and then spend more of our money on a doctor.
We won't be able to purchase all the supplies we came for. We were short on money as it was. We're lucky we're not laying in the ditch robbed and mugged ourselves. We'll all starve if you keep acting this way. We'll be the ones depending on the kindness of strangers. You know, old boy, charity starts at home."
"You're right, and we have all we need. We've got more than we need, and from those who have much, much is expected."
"And I know a fool and his money soon go separate ways," retorted P.
"Hoarding money doesn't help anybody, and if you only give your help and money expecting to get it back..."
"With interest," interrupted P.
"Then that is your reward, and that's not caring or sharing. You should help others with what you have because you can."
"We'll never see that money again."
"Helping others like we did may take a little food from your belly, but it's nourishing to the soul, Mr. P. If you give to and help others, it'll come back to you in good measure. Press down, you'll get back more than you gave."
"In case you're unaware, they call that interest in the financial world, old boy," pecked P.
"Well, getting more isn't so you'll have even more. It's so you can share even more. Getting all you can and canning all you get, that's not right. We should all share,"
was P's only reply. And so they went on to town and got their supplies. They were unable to get everything on the list. They also had to cut back on some grain and hay as well.
"Well, Buster, thanks to your generosity, it'll be slim pickings for us all this winter. Wait till the others hear about this. I certainly wouldn't want to be in your hooves when they do."
On the way home, they stopped at the inn where they had stayed with the little doggie. The innkeeper told Buster that the little dog had rested up and gone on his way. Everything had worked out fine, he explained. As Buster and P arrived home the next day, all of the animals ran out to the road to greet them. Their excitement over something was obvious.
"Well, it seems as though the others have heard the news and formed a lynch mob for you, old man. Bad news travels fast, eh, old boy?"
Peabody said, trying to throw in his last jab at Buster before being around the others.
"Curiosity may have killed the cat, as they say, but who'd have thought kindness would have killed the horse?"
P, laughing at his own bad humor, added. Buster prepared for the worst. Hootie excitedly explained how earlier that morning, two huge wagons had shown up at the farm. The wagons were piled so high with grain, wheat, and supplies, they had to tie it all in. It took a team of four horses to pull the huge wagons. Hootie had explained that they had not ordered nor could afford such a plethora of supplies. The horses told everyone the story of how Buster and Mr. P had helped the little hurt doggie several days ago. Well, as it turns out, the little doggie was the pup of an important and very wealthy big dog from a nearby farm. He had sent the supplies to Buster's farm out of gratitude. He had been touched by the way Buster and Mr. P had sacrificed their needs for those of a total stranger. Many others had passed, unconcerned for the little doggie, ignoring his moans and pleas for help. The big dog had sent more than enough supplies to last all of the animals a long, long, long time. He had also arranged a big party that night to thank Buster and Mr. P for their gallant giving. That evening, they had a fabulous feast filled with fun. The big dog got up to thank them.
I just want to thank you both for your caring and sharing spirit, while others just passed by not wanting to help or get involved with my little...
Peabody jumped up and pompously began,
Yes, yes, you know, as soon as I saw the little doggy ahead, I could tell he needed our help, and, well, helping others is something we should all do, a sacrifice at times, but let this be a lesson for us all. Doing good for others will always come back to you. Now, Buster, old boy, say a few words, if you will.
Yeah... It happened something like that, but all of this is overwhelming. We just did what we could do to help a neighbor, because as I see it, we all live at the same address, planet Earth, and that makes us all neighbors.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Hear, hear, they all cheered.